Thank you all very much for coming to this session, which is really important because we talk all the time about the SDGs, and of course the SDGs include climate. We talk about financing for development, and of course financing needs to include climate. But you know what? If we don't get a really good deal in Paris in December, then we can say goodbye to the SDGs and we can say goodbye to development. And we have a lot to do. I've put on the screen a chart which comes from the UNEP report, the emissions gap report. The takeaway from this graph is that if you take account of all the current pledges that have been made by countries, including, of course, the EU, the US-China agreement that was announced recently, and most of the big country pledges that we already have, we expect emissions in 2030 to be of the order of 57 gigatons. The science tells us that the pathway we need to be on to keep warming to 2 degrees is 42 gigatons. The only number you need to remember in the whole of climate change is 42, and many of you will know the book, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and the answer to the question of life, the universe, and everything is 42. So it's an easy way to remember it. But look at that gap between 57 and 42. That's a 25% in reduction in emissions that needs to be committed if we are to make sure that we stay on a 2-degree course. And in addition, people need to keep their promises and make sure those pledges are kept. And the evidence in the UNEP report is that some countries have made pledges and have kept them, and some countries have made pledges and have not kept them. And UNEP goes systematically through all the countries and tells you which countries are doing as they need to and which countries are not. So we have a mountain to climb before Paris. And an interesting topic of conversation will be whether or not we are going to get there, what it means if we don't, what kinds of different solutions are available. Now, the mechanism that's been agreed for delivering those changes, those commitments to mitigation, are called intended nationally determined contributions. INDCs. It's a piece of jargon which is completely incomprehensible to those of us who live in the real world, but it is familiar in the climate space. Every country has committed to produce an INDC, preferably by the middle of this year. The UNFCCC will add them all up later in the year, and they will be presented in Paris. And the topic of the debate today is to hear a little bit about how we're getting on with INDCs, but also to talk about the process of producing them. Because, you know, it's easy to produce a pledge. I could produce a pledge in 5 minutes with a piece of paper and a pen. But the pledge has to be real, has to be based on analysis, has to be based on what a country can do. So who are the sponsors of this meeting? First of all, the European Think Tanks Group, which I have the honor of chairing. That's think tanks in Germany, in Holland, in Spain, in the UK, and in France. DG Klima in the Commission. CDKN, the Climate and Development Knowledge Network, which I also chair. Sam Bickersteth, the CEO of CDKN, is in the room. And also the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who are, of course, hosting the meeting in Paris. And we could not have asked for a better panel of people to discuss this very practical question of what these INDCs mean, how we deliver change in the run-up to Paris, how we make sure that Paris is a success. Jos Del Becker, to start at this end, is a Director General in DG Klima. He has a team of how many negotiators at the moment in Bonn? 20 or 30, probably, of that order, trying to produce a deal. Belete Tefera Desta is the Minister for Environment and Forestry in Ethiopia, and one of the most progressive countries and most progressive ministries in trying to produce climate change commitments. His Excellency Chering Togai is the Prime Minister of Bhutan. And we're very honoured to have you with us, Your Excellency, today in this meeting. We look forward to hearing about Bhutan's commitment to climate change. Carmen Monges is from Paraguay and is a leader in climate change, a prize-winning activist with WWF and Paraguayan institutions working on the subject. Anne-Marie Descôtes is the Director General in the Department of Globalization, Development and Partnerships in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in France and has an inside track to what is going on in Paris and will be able to tell us. And then, unfortunately, Judy Wakungu, who is the Minister for Environment in Kenya, had a visa problem and was unable to join us, but has sent the most amazing replacement, Stephen Kinguya, who is in the Climate Change Secretariat, but is also co-chair of the Low Emissions Development S. What does the S stand for? Low Emissions Development... Anyway, LEDs. And he is a leading figure and comes from another country which takes climate change really seriously. In a second, I'm going to ask you to test the mood of the meeting, how you feel about Paris. Not in general, of course. Paris, beautiful city, the city of love. No padlocks anymore in Paris because they've taken them down. But about Paris in climate change. Then I'm going to ask the panelists to make some very brief initial comments, maybe 5 minutes maximum, just to open up the conversation that we want to have with them and with you during the next hour and a half or so about the prospects of really ambitious mitigation commitments. So before we start, let me just see how you feel about Paris. I'm going to ask you this question, and you can have three possible answers. Yes, no, or not. You can abstain. Are you optimistic about the Paris outcome when the UNFCCC meets in Paris? Do you think we will get a good global deal? Emphasis on good, a good global deal. Hands up if you are optimistic. Hands up if you are pessimistic. Hands up if you are thinking about something else. One or two, Paris, the city of love. Don't be distracted. You have a job to do to convince people that this process is going to deliver the change we need. There's quite a big majority who are skeptical. And what are they skeptical about? They're skeptical about the ability of diplomats and people like you around the world really to gather the political commitment we need to deliver change. So I'm going to work along the panel without regard to seniority and just ask you each to speak for a few minutes about how we solve that problem. Jos, if I may, I'll start with you.
Yes, if I may make 3 points.
You need a microphone, sorry. Oh, I should have said something else before you start. Some of our colleagues will be speaking in English, some in French, and some in Spanish. Probably you don't have your translation equipment. Hands up if you need interpretation. And, I mean, if you haven't got a gadget, hands up. Perhaps some can be distributed while Jos is speaking, and you will speak in English, I guess.
Thank you very much. This is a very welcome discussion. And I would like to make 3 short points. You mentioned the INDCs. They are, of course, essential, because we think that out of the 190 countries participating in the climate negotiations, all of them, and I would like to underline all of them, can make a contribution to climate change, or they are forced to adapt themselves to the consequences of climate change. And when I stress all of them, of course, it is well understood that these efforts are all going to be differentiated, because we are all different. Some are post-industrialized, some are industrialized, some have tropical rainforests, some have a lot of mountains, etc. We are all different. So the INDCs is the unique chance for every country to line out what is good for their own country and for climate change, and also what on top of that could be undertaken with the help of international financial aid coming from the Europeans, coming from the banking sector, etc. So having the INDCs spelled out for every country according to the particularities of every single country, what can be done autonomously, independently from external aid, and what can be done with the help of external aid, that would be a great help for Paris and the follow-up. My second point is on that follow-up. When I saw the hands going up on the optimists and the pessimists, where I think we have to be realistic is that these INDCs may not exactly lead us already to the 2 degrees Celsius. I think that is the line that is emerging from the INDCs on the table. So our thoughts should be, what are we going to agree in Paris, and what are we going to agree for the process after Paris? And in view of that, the European Commission, together with the Moroccan authorities, is organizing in Morocco on the 12th and 13th of October a kind of conference, a forum, to bring together a first assessment on collectively how far we are in reaching the 2 centigrades goal. And the third point I would like to underline is that we in the EU, we are committed to respect our contributions and our commitments that we have been taking in giving support, financial support, technical support, investment support to other parts of the world where it is needed. We have been doing that in the past. The EU is the biggest donor and will continue to contain remain as an important donor in the future. Just as an order of magnitude, in 2013, alone, the EU together was bringing on the table some 10 billion euros of support. We are also very present in the Green Climate Fund. We are very keen on adaptation. We have the Global Climate Change Alliance that is bringing forward support schemes. So we are going to stand behind the words and the commitments we have been giving in the past. And the INDCs is the unique opportunity to see for every single country where this support can best be used. Okay. So that is where the INDCs is the pillar to differentiate the efforts, but also to point at concrete action that can be undertaken by internal, but also by external initiatives.
My job here is partly to ask difficult questions. So let me ask you two difficult questions before we move on. The first is this. Are you, and not just you, preparing us for disappointment? Where we get an outcome in Paris which is clearly unsatisfactory, but you're going to tell us it's okay, it's not a failure because we're going to come back next year and do a bit more. And some people have said in the press and in academic circles that the five-year review process, for example, is just an excuse to postpone decisions even further down the line.
I would slightly disagree with that statement, because what is it that we learned in Europe when we have now some more than 10 years of climate policy? That is, starting the job is the most important thing to do. And so we should get away from the illusion that only through negotiation you get action. It is through implementation what you negotiated and brought on the table. So getting started is the most important thing to do, because we also learned in Europe, when we started our policy, we discovered new ways of cutting down greenhouse gas emissions. And when we started, we would never have thought that today, unanimously, our 28 leaders would have committed themselves to reduce the emissions by 40% in 2030 based on 1990 levels. So starting with the job in the field through concrete actions is the most important thing to do. And there, again, the INDCs is much progress. Even if it is not perfect in one go, you can make it perfect in two goes. And that is the lesson we learned in Europe, at least.
And my second question is, 40% reduction from 1990 by 2030. Have you discussed in Europe, and do you think that is your fair share? Because in the end, a lot of this reduction thing, my PowerPoint has gone, is actually about the ethics of who has access to the last remaining 1,000 gigatons of greenhouse gases. Are you taking more than your fair share, or is that about right?
Well, we have talked with all international experts, and that 40% reduction domestically, I would like to underline, that is our domestic intra-European effort, brings us into what scientists tell us we should do. That means the 2 degrees Celsius. But there is an important part that can be done on top of that, and that is the external part. And that is where I would like to underline that we stand to continue our support and to focus our support better. And the INDCs that all countries are going to bring on the table is the unique chance to better localize where action and investments and expenditure can be made.
Okay. And if everybody did as much as Europe, we would probably be in a much better place than we are likely to be, which is worth saying. Belete, tell us a little bit about Ethiopia, and maybe also react, if you'd like to what Jos has said.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for having such a very important event. Ethiopia sees Paris optimistically, in any way. Otherwise, we don't think we have any other option if we are sure to continue humanity in the globe. Paris should unite the different countries is the agenda that we have. Ethiopia in its context has tried to cope up with the conditionality. Of course, you know, Ethiopia, regardless of the recently seen economic development, but is still least developing country. And in this least developed countries, the convention does not oblige them really to make emission reduction. If any, in any case, it would be conditional to the kind of development support they get from the developed world. But otherwise, my government have been very much committed to implement its CRG strategy. Aggressively, it has been carrying out to overcome deforestation problem in the area, in the country. It has tried to intensify its agriculture system. It has tried to build its renewable energy systems efficiently. And this all is using its meager economic resource it has. Well, I cannot say the support from the developed world was not there. The question is whether it was adequate enough or not. Still, the government is consistently looking to implement the CRG line in line to the GDP, to the growth and transformation plan that we are anticipating for 2025. That aim is net carbon emission by 2025, achieving a middle income status. It goes beyond even. The final target for our green economy for the CRG is 2030. So the base year emission status for the country, 2010, 150 million metric ton was the calculated one. Taking the business as usual model, this is expected to reach 400 million metric tons by 2030. So we're planning to bring it down to 145 million metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent, which is 64% less of the business as usual. So in this regard, my government is very much committed, and it hopes also that the means of implementation support from the developed world will be still in a good track. Otherwise, I can see it. If we have any question, I will try to answer. But final point is, even we have a tracking, we have made a second national communication to the UNFCCC, and accordingly we found it, there is a significant reduction in the greenhouse gases. And this has been reflected is because of the massive social mobilization that we have carried out for the rehabilitation and management of the degraded landscapes. Yes, as we are doing well also in the other economic sectors, there could be a trend of increase in the greenhouse gas emission of these sectors, but it has adequately reversed because of the watershed management practices. This is what I can say.
Okay, thanks so much. Are you saying, just to clarify what you said at the beginning, that your commitment is conditional on developed countries providing more finance? Did I hear you say that?
Basically, this is part of the convention. I am not saying a new thing. In Article 4, sub-Article 7 and 9, it puts it conditional for the developed world to put a means of implementation for the developing countries' initiatives. This is how we understand it. But otherwise, this does not mean that we should be remaining hands tied up for any of these climate change problems. We have to do all the effort that each of our countries should do, given the capacity they have, to the best level of their capacity. This okay. And this is the principle that we are trying to adhere in our situation.
I'm making a list of questions we might want to come back to, and that is certainly one of them, that conditionality. Prime Minister, are your hands tied up in the way that Ethiopia might be? Tell us about your ambitions.
Thank you, Simon. Ambitions.
And INDCs and so on.
Our ambitions is to survive as a country, as a world. And I was very happy to be here. I am happy to be here, but I'm a little concerned that there are a lot more of us who are pessimistic about reaching a meaningful agreement in Paris than those of us who are optimistic. And this has direct consequences to all our futures and obviously to my country. My country is in the Himalayas. It's nothing but the Himalayas. It's a small country, it's landlocked. We will bear the brunt of climate change. We talk of 2 degrees, like with 2 degrees, everything is going to be balmy. But 2 degrees worldwide will translate to something much higher in the mountains. And that something much higher is going to melt our snows, melt our glaciers. That's going to cause flash floods. It's going to cause irreparable damage. It's going to cause desertification. And it's going to allow our glacial lakes to wreak havoc, not just in our country, but through our country, to the low-lying areas, our neighbors. As such, the stakes for Bhutan, make no doubt, is survival. Our ambition is to survive. To survive, we are willing to contribute what it takes. Because we know that we can't adapt to the consequences of climate change like perhaps some of the other countries can. For us, adaptation, the choice of adaptation doesn't exist because the country as we know it, our country as we know it, will not exist. We will not be able to adapt. And so what are the contributions that we are making? We, by law, our constitution requires that a minimum of 60% of a land is maintained under forest cover. This is required by constitution. As of now, 72% is under forest cover. In 2009, at COP15, we made a pledge that we will be carbon neutral for all time to come. Today, we are carbon negative. Our forests are a carbon sink of about 6.3 megatons of carbon dioxide per year. We generate about 2.4 megatons of carbon dioxide per year. So we are negative by about 3.9 megatons of carbon dioxide per year.
That's worth a round of applause. That is a remarkable achievement.
Thank you. But that's nothing. We need to do a lot more. So more than half our country is protected as nature reserves. We have a national strategy for lowering carbon emissions. We are undertaking a very comprehensive forestry inventory right now to really understand how healthy our forests are. Are they really absorbing the amount of carbon that we claim that they are? Perhaps they are absorbing less, in which case we need to do more. Perhaps they are absorbing more, in which case we still need to do more. But for Bhutan, one of the big opportunities I see is offsetting carbon emissions elsewhere. Our rivers, if we can protect the sanctity of our rivers, can generate a lot more renewable runoff the river hydropower. Today, we have about just 1,600 megawatts of power that, if they were used to calculate it to offset carbon emissions, this 1,600 megawatts of hydropower can offset about 3 million metric tons of carbon dioxide. We are in the process of developing another 3,000 megawatts of hydropower. And those 3,000 megawatts of hydropower are calculated. This is some of them are already registered with the CDM, as CDM projects, can offset carbon dioxide to the tune of 11 million tons of carbon dioxide per year. Our total capacity is 30,000 megawatts of hydropower. If we were to harness that 30,000 megawatts of hydropower, we can offset something like 112 million tons of carbon dioxide per year. That assumes that 80% of the hydropower we generate is exported to our neighbors, especially to India, because that hydropower used in India will offset fossil fuels that they would use to otherwise generate that power.
Very good. Thank you very much. Can I just borrow the microphone? Let me just summarize where we've got to and just see how you feel about that. What are the optimists telling us? We're on the road. We know we want to be ambitious. We can do this to a certain extent by ourselves. We will do our fair share. And there are huge opportunities, as we've heard, in countries around the world, including in Bhutan. On the other hand, actually, there's a lot to do. It's conditional on international support. It's really conditional on a global partnership so that these offsetting mechanisms will also work. The politics is still quite difficult in terms of getting a deal because some of these issues are very strongly held. So before I go to the rest of the panel, I want to take just three or four comments on that positive or negative story. And these are the rules. You please stand up, you say who you are, you say something completely fascinating, and you sit down again. And you have 90 seconds to do it in because we want to keep the conversation moving. So I'll take two or three. Who'd like to go first? Any comment on what you've heard so far? Please, over there. Here, take this one.
Thank you very much. My name is Aaron Leopold. I work with Practical Action. We're an NGO that's worked in the climate and energy space for a number of decades. And I just wanted to thank you, Mr. Prime Minister, for mentioning the run-of-the-river micro-hydro plants that Bhutan has immense potential for. And I wanted to note, within the context of climate change, we need to really start discussing the broader energy issues of the 21st century, which are climate change and energy access. And decentralized solutions such as the run-of-the-river micro-hydro plants are something that climate finance needs to be supporting. But the discussions between the two energy issues are really at polar opposites at the moment. It's either or, but really it's the same issue, and I'm very happy that we've begun this discussion in Bhutan, and we need to continue through to Paris to discuss energy, not only climate energy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Who else? Anybody? Is there a microphone over there? That would be good. There's one coming behind you.
Thank you. I'm from the International Francophonie Organization, the Brussels office. For several years now, I've been following this process, and I have to say that I think we've arrived at a crucial turning point now. My question is as follows. Many developing countries today are starting to prepare their national contributions with a lot of good faith. However, we know that in developing countries in particular, there's a critical lack of human resources, know-how, and unfortunately, financial resources as well. Now, if after Paris we realize that those countries, even with the best will in the world, and even with the best preparation in the world that they've prepared their contributions, if we discover afterwards that they cannot keep those commitments, what can we do then to stay within that 2-degree limit?
We'll come back to one more. Anybody? Yes, lady there.
Bonjour, mon nom est Geneviève Ponce.
Geneviève Ponce. I have been working on climate for many, many years now. I arrived in 92 with JOS, but that's another story altogether. I'll spare you it. I'm now the new director of WWF Europe. And I just have a question on terminology. I don't think it's important to know if you're optimistic or pessimistic. That's more about characteristics, personality. I think what's important is to know whether we're being active or proactive or not. And that's something that Pascal Lamy, at the head of the WTO, when he was, often asked. Didn't really bother about being optimistic or pessimistic. He said, I'm neither. I'm proactive or I'm active. And I think that's what we need to be now.
Congratulations on the new job. It's possible to be optimistic and activist and maybe even pessimistic and activist, but I think you're completely right to focus on activism. And that's a very good link, I think, to the next speaker. Carmen, you're going to speak in Spanish, I think.
Hola, mi nombre es Carmen Monjes.
Hello, my name is Carmen Monjes. I'm from Paraguay. I'm 21 years old. I wonder what is the value of life in the negotiations on climate change. I'm sure you must have asked yourselves the question at some stage, what is the value of a life in the negotiations in climate change? We've learned two things from Kyoto, I think. The first is, we are all part of this world. Therefore, we should all make a commitment and contribute to this universality. Now, we talk about contributions and the zero line minimum, but we hope that things will increase. But we need the commitment and the contributions. But in order for this, we need to render accounts. We need to report. We have to have mechanisms for people to be accountable. But I can make a commitment, but I want to know what's happening. How can I assess or judge the impact of what is being done? How can the youth also become involved in the dialogue that those gentlemen and ladies are involved in? I must say, actions speak louder than words, you know, and I'm 21. I represent young people in my country who want to change the cities and transform them into sustainable cities. But how should we do this? We have to look at what brings us together, what is our common interest, what motivates us all. And then we need to provide information to people about the indicators and the results, quality of life and municipal management. And we need to be informed, so inform people so that they can have an impact on public policy. It's not easy. Negotiations are never easy. But we do intend to improve, and this must translate into action. What do we young people want? We want to work with you. So listen to us. Look at us. Thank you.
Carmen. For those of you who want activism, there you have a very good example, but also results, which is very important, I think. Anne-Marie, I imagine you're a realist and an activist. How is Paris going? Tell us about it.
Merci beaucoup.
Well, thank you very much. And yes, I think that's a good way of summarizing the situation. We are obviously optimistic. I think you have to be, right till the very end. I would just like to react to what's just been said, because I think it's extremely important to react to that. Obviously, these national contributions are a key element of the agreement. Now, what we are striving towards is an ambitious agreement, of course. It's a kind of an alliance where there will be the agreement itself, which hopefully will be binding and universal. You will have the national contributions. There's also the issue of the financing, of course, to respond to the question that was raised before. How do we ensure that we subsequently implement what we decide upon? And then there's the agenda to come up with the technological solutions that might be made available to implement the targets that we've agreed to. So the INDCs are absolutely key to this alliance, and I think everybody's understood that. But I think it's important to also stress the fact that these contributions are essential for another reason. The ultimate goal, the ultimate ambition of the agreement will just be the sum of each individual national ambition. And that's an important point. The INDCs will have to be built in a very serious way, a very practical way. Countries will have to look very carefully and come up with very specific and detailed contributions. They'll have to explain how they are going to achieve the targets they set themselves. And as has just been said, everybody has to participate. Now, at this moment in time, now before we get the agreement and before the preparations of the INDCs are finished, what we really need is to mobilize the people, to get this feeling that everybody is taking ownership of this process. This is not just about governments taking decisions. It's not just about companies taking these decisions. It's about everybody taking these decisions together. And so we need the general population, citizens, to take ownership of this process, to help then ultimately in the implementation of the INDCs and the agreement in general. Now, obviously, we are aware of the fact that this, for some countries, may well be very difficult. Coming up with INDCs is not easy, and that's why Jos Delbecq said a moment ago there are support and help mechanisms that are being implemented by multilateral donors. We are also doing it at a national level. We have chosen to help 23 countries, 23 of the poorer countries, to help them with their INDCs. Now, obviously, they need to tell us what their needs are. Some countries want help in terms of the overall building of their contributions. Other countries want help in specific sectors. Others want help in terms of creating evaluation mechanisms, which is also an important element of all this. If we want this agreement to be solid, sound, and transparent, then we also need to look at evaluation mechanisms and assessment mechanisms. So this is very much a collective project. And as the future presidency, we feel that INDCs are an essential part of the agreement. But now, today, because of that, it's our duty to help everybody to make this contribution.
And we have these INDCs which don't add up to anything like 2 degrees. What will your Prime Minister be saying to the press the day after it finishes?
Well, firstly, if these negotiations are managed well, and I think they are being managed well, because all parties are doing their utmost, then this essential part of it, these INDCs, won't necessarily be discovered just in Paris. We will already be getting information about them, and we will just get contribution that the sum of the contributions will or will not allow us to achieve the 2-degree target. Because obviously the contributions need to be realistic as well as ambitious. So we need to work on a more long-term mechanism as well. Because it's not just about getting these contributions and then stopping. We will have to have a multi-stage approach, a much more far-reaching long-term mechanism as well, to ensure that the contributions that are taken or committed to are actually implemented. So we need to monitor and follow up on these contributions as well in the long term.
And I think it's an entirely plausible proposition to say that we are going to lock in the initial commitments and then revisit every 5 years, and that this is a step-by-step process. it's kind of a pity it's taken us until 2015 to get to this point when we could have started in 1990, but at least we have all the countries now and not just Annex 1 and the non-Annex 1 countries left aside. Stephen, you're from a non-Annex 1 country, so you've been brought into this process. Do you think that's fair and reasonable, and are you going to be able to deliver an INDC?
Thank you, Chair. I'll try to answer your question. First and foremost, I would want to register our gratitude as a country for being invited to participate in this panel. And I am representing my minister, and therefore I will say as much as a statement can say, and then perhaps a few questions from the participants. First and foremost, I think we all have a role to play in addressing climate change, whether from developing country parties or from developed country parties, because we have had a role in its cause, no matter how small that role might be. Of course, there are those with a bigger historical responsibility. There are those without a big historical responsibility. But I think the fact of the matter is that those without historical responsibility today might perhaps have a historical responsibility tomorrow if they do not do things the right way. So INDCs to us present a unique opportunity for the global community to show their commitment in addressing climate change. As a country, we are in the process of preparing our INDC that we hope to submit well in advance of the 1st of October deadline, of course, for inclusion in the synthesis report to be prepared by the UNFC Secretariat. We have done at least most of the groundwork, because in 2010, we launched a National Climate Change Response Strategy, which was the very first official document, of course, acknowledging the reality of climate change and its impacts in the various sectors of our economy. And then we followed that up with a National Climate Change Action Plan, which is pretty comprehensive, addressing the vulnerabilities in the different sectors and addressing also the emissions, of course, from the different sectors, and also with a clear analysis of the GHG abatement potential or the GHG mitigation potential. And therefore, and of course, at a lower level, of course, with the kind of actions also proposing the kind of actions that need to be put in place to ensure that those mitigation potentials are realized. And then we have also followed that up with a draft National Climate Change Framework Policy that's already with the cabinet, and we hope perhaps before the end of the next 2 months, perhaps it will have already been approved and by the cabinet. And of course, accompanying that is a comprehensive national climate change bill, which has already passed the first House of Parliament, the National Assembly, and it's now has already been considered actually by the Senate. And then after that, perhaps when now the Senate releases it officially, then it will go to the President for assent and it becomes law. I'm painting this deliberately because then some of the challenges, of course, facing many developing countries is perhaps the legal status of some of the actions, whether they are constitutional or not constitutional, the political buy-in, and through the National Climate Change Action Plan, we got a lot of political buy-in, and we do not expect to have difficulties in getting, political buy-in in INDC. Now, that said and done, of course, then I would also want to point, perhaps, to pinpoint some of the challenges, of course, developing countries are facing in their preparation, in the preparation of their INDCs. One, of course, is that the Conference of Parties decisions themselves are not very clear, they are not very specific, choosing at times to use words like may or some, instead of being much more obligatory, and therefore, of course, giving the parties, of course, then the onus of deciding perhaps what they will do, what they cannot do, and how they will do it, because when you use may in terms of the scope or in terms of course the methodologies amongst others, then of course then that onus, of course, that responsibility of deciding what needs to be done from any party, of course, then remains with the party. So that's one of the challenges. Two, two, I think we started the INDC process, of course, and these, all of us, of course, are privy to this, perhaps, because we started the INDC preparation process long before, of course, any clear guidelines were prepared. And this has also had, of course, posed some challenges, because even now, by now, of course, some of the areas are still gray. And then, of course, there is the aspect of the means of implementation, because many developing country parties, of course, will perhaps ask themselves what perhaps they can do using their domestic resources, and what they cannot do, they will still perhaps propose it. But then again, its implementation then will be contingent upon the availability or accessibility of support in terms of capacity building, in terms of technology, and in terms of finance. And therefore, these are real challenges. And then there is another challenge that perhaps many of us might not be privy to, because many developing countries might not have as good historical data as developed countries, where, of course, then to get a very good and dependable time series that will perhaps give a more clearer figure of the situation might not be very easy for many developing countries. And therefore, these are some of the issues. But I am saying, of course, on behalf of my minister, that as a global community, I think we can achieve more by pulling resources together, by working together for a common goal than arguing from across the table. One of the areas, because this has been touched by the previous speakers, of course, is the link between the INDC process and the Paris Agreement. And for us, we see still some level of uncertainty because it is the Paris Agreement itself is being, of course, discussed. And we are not sure, of course, we can only imagine, of course, the form and shape it will take. And therefore, again, for us, we are still thinking it is still a bit early to imagine how the INDCs will be angered in the Paris Agreement. But we are hopeful that at least something for the good of the global community will come out of Paris. And we are ready to play, of course, a rightful role as a party to the UNFCCC and as members of the global community to ensure that all is not lost, of course, in addressing climate change. I think I can pause at that point and then perhaps a few questions from the participants. Thank you.
Very good. And thank you for your leadership of the LEDS partnership and the other things you do. Now, look, if this conference was taking place at a climate event, at a conference of the parties, there would be outside lots of people in polar bear costumes trying to raise the importance of the issue and investigate in more detail some of the things we've discussed. So I want you to imagine you are the polar bears. You are wearing your polar bear costume, you are carrying your placard, and you want to make a really big point about climate change to politicians, of whom we have two on the platform, to activists, or to professional sort of managers of the process, if I can describe you in that way. You are the polar bears. You feel passionately about this topic. You have, as usual, 90 seconds. Maybe you need to take off your hood because we won't hear you if you're wearing your polar bear costume. How are we getting on? Tell us whether or not you have a message for the politicians or the activists or the managers. Can we have a microphone? One there. First, I'll come to you if there's time in a second, and then at the front.
Hi, I'm Frauke. I'm a student, and I was wondering, I'm going to make it very, very, very short, because I was just wondering, like, how obligatory will the INDCs be? And, that's actually the whole question. I really hope that we can make certain measurable goals, and that there are mechanisms to follow up on these countries and mechanisms to actually see which countries did not attain these goals and what can be done about that.
If I put this in polar bear terms, if I may, you could be saying these INDCs are not worth the paper they're written on because actually there is no legal backup to the whole of the process. Is that too strong? Okay, let's come to the front. Sam.
Thank you very much, Simon. My name's Sam Bickersteth. I'm the chief executive of CDKN, and we're very I'm delighted to be co-hosting this event. There are five representatives of states on the panel, European Union, France, Ethiopia, Kenya and Bhutan. You're the leaders here. You're progressive. That's not the case across the rest of the world in terms of climate action. I think we've heard so eloquently put by you, Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of Bhutan, that we can get to net zero emissions. We've heard from Ethiopia how net emissions are falling. Really important and optimistic. Maybe I'm moving to the optimistic side. But my question to all of you panelists is, how do you bring others with you? How's Europe taken all its member states with it? There's a really important lesson there. How can you take your neighbours in South Asia with you on this journey? How can you take your neighbours in Africa to take this leadership position that you've demonstrated to us today?
Just turn this into a proposition, Sam, because you know as much about this as anybody here. What do you think they should be doing?
Within the international sphere, whether it's in the UNFCCC groupings or whether in the negotiations in the SDGs coming up in New York or in other forums such as SARC in South Asia or the African Union, how do you use those forums to drive this agenda?
We had a discussion yesterday with Mrs. Mogherini about building consensus, and there are different aspects to leadership. There's persuasion, but there's also putting the right incentives in place. There's offering opportunities to people. I'm always quoting this, but you know, Martin Luther King did not say, "I have a nightmare." He said, "I have a dream." And so the whole idea of green technology as a route to prosperity is one of the things that can be said to those countries. Okay, any more polar bears? Two more over here. I'm holding you because you've already spoken, but let's see how we get on. Yes.
Hello. I would put on a panel for Climate Alliance. I would like to highlight the good work of our 1,700 members, which are local authorities in Europe in partnership with indigenous people in the Amazon basin. And they submitted their concrete action points to the Road of Paris, which you can find on our website. And I would like to highlight just the example of how you can go from some good examples that are happening across our world towards the mainstreaming, towards scaling up. One example is a covenant of mayors. It's an initiative of the European Commission, and it's about how local authorities are making a political commitment. They are submitting sustainable energy action plans, and we are monitoring these because it's about concrete implementation. And I would put on my panel that we are extremely proud to see that there are 6,600 of those local authorities taking the concrete action. So I would like to see on this panel, please take into account, recognize the role of the local authorities in all the policies you're going to make. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll take two more polar bears. We'll take the woman there, and then we'll come back to you, WWF, and then we'll come to the panel.
Thank you very much, Simon. I'm Lies Kleines from Oxfam International. It's funny you mentioned the polar bears. Oxfam had a campaign at the time of Copenhagen. We were all dressed up as polar bears, but basically calling to save the humans, because at this stage, what is really happening is humanity at stake, and particularly people in developing countries. Climate finance has been mentioned a lot. I wanted to talk about, or ask at least the people on the panel, is the Paris deal going to be a deal for the big emitters only? Is it going to address the questions of competition and carbon leakage by having everyone, the big emitters, making some of the big commitments? Or what will be on the table for some of the poorest developing countries? Ethiopia, for example, being one, we've been looking as Oxfam into what Ethiopia is already dishing out itself from its own budgets to deal with climate change, what it's spending on adaptation already. Shows that there's already spending twice a year what it got in fast start finance for over 3 years. So it's doing actually much more itself than it's getting in contributions from international donors. So the question really to the Ethiopian minister is, what do you want to see in terms of adaptation and global goals for adaptation within the agreement, and what kind of finance needs to be backing that up?
Okay.
Second question is to the Commission. We're
not doing really questions. We're doing strong arguments.
Strong statements.
Give
okay.
us a strong argument.
Fine. We have lots of support recently for carbon pricing. Getting World Bank, IMF talking about carbon pricing as one of the instruments that needs to be part of the Paris deal. If that works, okay, fine, we can go with that. Part of that finance needs to be flowing to developing countries. It needs to be going through the Green Climate Fund, needs to help with that climate finance challenge. We have a directive coming up here in the EU, looking at ETS. Can that play a role in providing some of that extra climate finance? And I think that's a concrete solution we could put things together. Thanks.
Thanks very much. And finally, the last polar bear for now. We'll come back to you later. Yep.
Hello. Ce que l'on entend.
When we listen to Carmen, for example, what we hear is enthusiasm, is willingness to help. With a microphone, please, yes. It's a willingness to help and to participate in this climate effort. She represents young people, a young generation, but she also represents civil society. This enthusiasm, this willingness to help, can be found in large segments of the society, for example, in business circles, of course, in NGOs. So my question is, these national contributions, do they take into account the willingness to participate of the civil society, young people, and companies? I was at the Business and Climate Conference in Paris, and there were a number of companies that wanted to mobilize, were asking for carbon pricing and wanted decisions. And on the other hand, Mr. Hollande was saying, come to Paris with sectoral plans for CO2 reductions, emission reductions. So my question is very specific. These INDCs, intended nationally determined contributions, do they take into account all of civil society, which is now mobilizing for climate change?
Because you had your hand up and you're right there. But don't ask a question, say something.
Yeah, a comment. Hello, I'm Nada, one of the 15 future leaders. And I will speak in French, it's okay? Okay.
Yesterday, we discussed a consensus with Madame Mogherini and the difficulties of reaching agreements in international regional organizations. I was at the Paris summit. I hope there'll be solutions for new technologies, etc. Well, I'd also like regional institutions to participate fully in investments in renewable energies in developing countries. In Morocco, the EU has invested over 9 million euros for the solar plants for the south. And I hope that we'll have to. The developed countries are the biggest polluters. They are the industrial countries. We hope that they will turn to the ministries of industry and invest in transformation, the transformation of energy, for example, that is used by companies in the countries that are done, for example, to improve the situation also in the developing countries. So I'd like to call for better local intervention by developed countries to help to change the situation in developing countries to contribute significantly to reduction in their reducing greenhouse gas emissions.
Topics. Some of them are questions, some of them have been contributions. Let's try not to answer each question individually, but I want to break the last half an hour into three blocks. Actually, two blocks. A political come activist block, which is the Prime Minister, the Minister, and Carmen as an activist, which is about dealing with these issues about how do we get the public, where are the polar bears, how do we make sure there is enough political pressure to get a deal. Then I want to turn to the people I think of as the managers and the negotiators of the process to talk about all these different building blocks that we've looked at and what problems you face in making sure that they all add up in Paris. So let's try and split the discussion a little bit that way. Prime Minister, we'll start with you and your other colleagues from the political activist side. Prime Minister, have you lost your microphone in the process here? It's been appropriated by a developed country, probably.
Well, Simon, the first thing I want to ask the polar bears is, why is it that all the women polar bears have come out? And then my direct request to you would be to get the males out too. Get the male polar bears also out. For Bhutan, again, very small country, only 750,000 people, one of the smallest GDPs in the world. Our GDP stands at $1.7 billion only. That's 169 out of 190 odd countries. It's very small GDP. What we can offer the world and ourselves is, in the global context, limited. If we go all out and if we get assistance, we're getting a lot of help from the EU, thank you very much. We get a tremendous amount of help from India. Our hydropower is developed in partnership with India. If we can develop our potential, we can contribute, like I said earlier, about 112 million metric tons of carbon offset a year. That is significant. But we need to work hard together and over many years to get to that target. What we can offer today is really our best shot. We announced to the world, nobody prompted us to do so. We said we will remain carbon neutral for all time. Right now we are carbon negative. We are looking at our forests. We are expanding our forests. We have something called Bhutan for Life that's going to take care of our protected areas, a financing scheme that's going to take care of our protected areas. But there's a lot more to do. We need to, the government is making initiatives to go paperless. We are into sustainable transport. Again, on a global scale, it's very little contributions. But the point is, nobody is telling us to go sustainable in our agriculture and in our transport. We are doing it. And why are we doing it? Because it's good for us, it's good for the world, it's good for our futures, and not just for my own children, it's good for all our children. We are fortunate that we have a development philosophy, one that was conceived of and given to us by our kings. It's called Gross National Happiness. That attempts to balance the material progress that is really required with inclusive social growth, inclusive social progress, but in a sustainable manner while taking care of our environment and all within the framework of good governance. So we are fortunate we have grown up under the ideals and principles of gross national happiness that really not just require us to take care of the environment and to be mindful of our environment, it is almost something innate. And that innateness, we don't see it as a contribution, we see it as our obligation, and this is something that we will offer to Paris and to the world.
We have some very nice pictures. I suppose that's Bhutan. I have a proposal that we have the European Development Days in Bhutan. We'll all come to Thimphu. It looks fantastic.
Yes, let's do that.
I want to ask you about how you see politically the catastrophist approach to climate change, which we often hear. Our islands are at risk, our livelihoods. What I want to know is, when you work internationally as Prime Minister and you're talking to rich countries, does that work? Is it enough as an argument to make the case for climate change?
I'm not into instilling guilt into people. And political leaders are going to be the last ones that are going to bite. Okay, and this is not about a guilt trip. It is about our shared world. Now, within our shared world, we have our individual parts to play. And we say it as it is. Bhutan is at risk. It is at risk. Not to extract any rewards from you, not to extract any assistance from you, but because that is reality. Because it is reality, we must do our part. We must be willing to do our part, and we are.
Okay, thank you. Carmen, I'm going to go to you next, because as an activist, you're one of the polar bears. And the question is, what are the blockages you face in making that? I mean, it seems so obvious that we should deal with climate change. Why is it so difficult?
Well, why is it difficult? Well, I don't think we can find a common interest together. People always say that activists, we live in a sort of utopian philosophical world. But I have to tell you that we want our motivation to be translated into action. But it's a bit difficult to reach an agreement because it's difficult to connect the two things, intentions with actions. I think, basically, this is something that is significant to all of us, and we all are living on this planet, and we have to live here, and life brings us together and unites us. It's not a matter of a past, present, future. We're talking about our dignity.
Okay, but now we heard from some people in the room about bottom-up, local government, cities, and you're very active at the city level. One of the pillars of the Paris Agreement is the idea that, okay, we'll have a global agreement, but we will also celebrate all the action that's happening, which may be even better than the global agreement, in cities, in sectors, in industries, and so on. So in Paraguay, is there enthusiasm for local work which is going faster than what is happening at the government level?
Okay.
In Paraguay, we are at an initial stage in relation to our national contributions. We're at the beginning in relation to communicating on climate change. Political will is quite strong. We'd like this to be a very relevant element on the political agenda. But to answer the question, this action that we want to see, how do we make it become a reality? Well, this is what we're working on, establishing the link between civil society, individuals, people, just normal people like ourselves, as well as the private sector and the government sector, to make sure that all look towards one common goal and work towards a common interest.
Belete, you're the other minister on the panel. Do you have polar bears in Ethiopia? Probably not. Do you have polar bears? You need a microphone, sorry.
It is common that I assume there are these polar bears everywhere. So I cannot deny there will not be. And anyway, to just give a reflection to some of these points raised, Ethiopia is one of the countries that has long faced the severe climate-related problems, the droughts that you all know, and famine, and flooding, the forest fire outbreaks, and diseases, whatever. What we really trying to do is, I think we have to see internally to ourselves. Not only we have these problems, but we have to look also the opportunities we can have. So what we trying to do as much as possible is to optimize the internal potential capacity we have and show that we can still tackle these problems to the best level of the capacity. Then there was a question, how are you helping others also to come into the board? I think the best thing that we can do is, yes, we can actively participate in any of the forums, share our experiences, but it is only when you have the success stories that could help and people could follow you as well. So we're trying to do to ourselves that this works for our conditionalities, regardless of what kind of support we're getting from outside or not. And then obviously, as we're doing it for our best, and producing a result, yes, obviously, any of the international community could be also in line to fill the gap we have. This is how we're trying to address these issues. And with this, we are positive enough, we are optimistic enough that we can make this change. There was also another question raised by there. Well, you know, we are agrarian country. We still have a huge number of our community depending on agriculture. And this agriculture, it has suffered seriously for the, that of imbalances, the degradation and so. And then we don't have any of the technology, we don't have any of the knowledge that is compatible or enough to what it demands us. We don't have the finance even, but what we have tried most is to mobilize the people to do the purpose, because that is the only ample resource we have. And then, yes, in this regard, thanks, many of our development partners are also positively supporting us in building our capacity, in implementation capacity, in providing us with also the necessary technologies and finances. So I think with this, we can still continue to make change is what I can tell you. Thank you.
Look, the polar bear has followed you. It's arrived. Just before you have the mic, leave the microphone. If you have these ambitious plans in Ethiopia, let me go back one step. If we have ambitious plans in Europe, there are winners, but there are also losers. And one of the big challenges that policymakers face is to compensate or persuade the losers. In Ethiopia, are there any losers?
Well, probably the thinking could be different. There would be losers in any case, but we have to have a clear direction of on how we compensate that. Otherwise, anything, this program, this action that we are doing, what we think is, as long as it serves the great mass of our people and the country, then we have to opt for that. And therefore, any of the losers, obviously, we have to look into the mechanism, how we're going to address them so that they can really be compensated enough.
Okay. Just, I'm going to come to you more in more detail, but on this particular point, do you want a two-hander?
Well, I think the challenge for policymakers is to make the potential losers part of the solution. And I think what we did in Europe is mainstream climate change in our policies, including in our budget. 20% of the European budget is climate related, also on development cooperation, but also internally. So you have to shift around funds where they are mostly needed. And I think that's a challenge, but it is possible to do it.
Okay, we have a quarter of an hour. I want to make sure we have time for our three sort of technical negotiation managers to contribute. But before we do that, anybody want to say one thing? One person say one thing. Can we have a microphone here? Let me borrow a microphone. I really want to know whether people are angry or not, or just happy to go along with the way in which all this is being presented. Yes.
Thank you. My name is Isabel Cassius. I'm professor of economics at the University of Louvain. You were talking about green technologies. I'm surprised that we don't scream that we won't make it. We won't make it only with green technologies. We have to change our pattern of consumption. We have to fight against advertisement that make us consume always more and more. And the richer countries have a heavy responsibility in this. And I want to thank Bhutan for having proposed another kind of model of development model with sufficiency thresholds. And if we were adopting sufficiency thresholds that are set behind the GNH index, it would be a revolution that would solve lots of problems.
Thank you. Also, that means we couldn't afford the air miles to go to Bhutan for the European Development Days. What a pity. Stephen, I want to go to you, and perhaps not only with your Kenya hat on, but also your Africa hat through LEDs, on this issue of the different building blocks of the deal in Paris, the capacity, the finance, the ambition of the INDCs.
Well, thank you, Chair. That's a difficult one, isn't it? But I think from my own experience, from the Kenyan experience, and from the African experience, because sometimes I'm an active participant in that forum. So I think for sure many of these issues coming up from developing countries are real. For one, as a country, we cannot wait. I'm talking now as Kenya. We cannot wait until support is availed from developed countries. We must take action. Because to us, of course, tackling climate change is a matter of survival. It's not just another option. And part of what we have done is to integrate the outcomes of our National Climate Change Action Plan into our development cycle. We develop using a 5-year medium-term plans. And the current medium-term plan, that lapses in June 2018 has a lot of integration of the recommendations from the National Climate Change Action Plan. That's what we have done as a country using domestic resources. And we will continue acting on both mitigation and adaptation. Why? Because it is good for the country. And that's exactly what our stakeholders told us when we went around for stakeholder consultation. Because I've heard also some of the issues, I know that does not have your blessing, Chair, but I've heard some of the issues coming from the floor are like the involvement of non-state actors, the CSOs, the civil society, the NGOs, the private sector. And we have tried as much as possible as a country to bring on board all those other actors that are from outside the government. Both, like for the IND, INDC process, we have a national task force which is gazetted by our minister to give it a legal backing. And we have two representatives of the Kenya private sector. We have two representatives of the Kenyan CSOs. And then we have several government representatives, of course, representing, actually three representatives of CSOs and NGOs. And then we have different government representatives, of course, representing different sector interests. And that's only a team of about 13 people. And I'm painting this because one of the questions that was asked, especially by Sam, is how to bring our neighbors on board or to pull our neighbors along. And part of it is ideally doing the right thing so that they see it is working and it is good for the country, it is good for the stakeholders. And of course, then there'll be buy-in. On the balance between, of course, the delivering in Paris and of course the other needs in terms of technology, in terms of capacity building, in terms of finance. I think this seriously needs to be addressed because for sure a developing country can only do as much. And I'm saying as a country we will continue doing what we can with our resources, whether we get support from developed countries or not. We are getting some support, but we are saying we would still continue for national good. One, because many of the issues that we are taking along to address climate change are integrated in our constitution. It's not bargainable. Like delivering to every Kenyan a clean and a healthy environment is a constitution. Actually, it's one of the citizens' rights under the Bill of Rights in our constitution. Ensuring that the forest to us is important because our biggest emissions are from the afolu sector. And therefore, we have one of the constitutional requirements is to up the forest cover to 10% of the total aerial coverage and maintain it at that level at the very minimum. 10% might look small for some of the countries, but it's not small for Kenya because 80% of Kenya is arid and semi-arid. And therefore, we are only talking about taking 10% for forest cover from the 80% that is not arid and semi-arid. And to us, that's a big contribution. So, because again, in terms of abatement potential, forests have the biggest potential to abate against the greenhouse gas emissions from our country, and therefore we have a lot of potential by just working at the constitutional requirement of 10% forest cover, amongst others, of course. So I think there can be a balance here. There can be a balance if there is a willingness from across the board. And from our side as a country, there is a lot of willingness. We also, from the other perspective, that because I see, as a co-chair of the Africa LEADS Partnership and the LEADS Global Partnership, what we are doing is to sensitize countries, especially members of our partnerships, to get involved in low-carbon, climate-resilient development for their own good. And we think this is good for the globe because once we go, we develop along a low-carbon, climate-resilient development, but then we are addressing two aspects. It's like having a double-edged sword, where you are addressing issues of adaptation or climate-compatible development and also issues of mitigation to climate change. And we think there is some light at the end of the tunnel and there is hope for Paris. That's our parting shot. Thank you.
Light at the end of the tunnel. I'm sorry to close you down a little bit. Have you got to go with the annual report? I'm going to go Jos first and then give our French colleague the chance to bring things together for Paris. We have about 8 minutes left, so take three. Jos, you need a microphone. We seem to have...
Yeah. Okay. I think what we heard is basically good news because more INDCs are coming on the table. And there was the question, how serious are they going to be and are they going to be implemented? I think that what I also heard from the panelists here is that there is a lot of political buy-in on these INDCs. And I think that's very important because what we saw in the past, it was not always a pleasant experience in the Kyoto Protocol. Those who were not respecting their obligations just walked out, which is not a way to go. So political buy-in is very important, and we have now the INDCs. Paris should drop the I. So the intended nationally determined contributions should become the national contributions. And so there should be a vehicle for implementation, And I think what I also heard is that there is a combination of economic and climate and environmental interests that are going to be clustered. It is about climate concerns, but it is also about forestry, it is about energy, it is about sustainable energy, renewable energy, and I think that is exactly the way to look at things, and that is where the INDCs are really an opportunity. And if Paris can consolidate them, then define what needs to be done on top of that. And that is where development cooperation comes in, climate finance comes in, and that is where we have to prepare our act and be much more specific about public sources of finance, but also private sources of finance. The carbon market was mentioned. There are also a lot of banks mobilizing climate finance funds, etc. So I think that combining public-private on the basis of good and solid plans that have a political buy-in at the highest level. And for that reason, I welcome very much that the Prime Minister of Bhutan is here today, because that's an indication that at the highest level, it's there that the political buy-in needs to be endorsed. And that is also what we did in Europe, by the way, by involving the heads of state. It's not always easy. But it is worthwhile to go that extra mile, because that's the best guarantee for implementation.
Thank you very much. Anne-Marie.
Merci. Je voudrais faire quelques
Thank you. I'd just like to make some comments as a reaction to other things that have been said, and then perhaps give a few conclusions. But I will be brief. Several people have mentioned what is being done by some big companies, by local authorities, and by different players. And I would just like to confirm that, of course, all of that is being taken into account in the road to Paris. And of course, we do need all actors, all players, to continue working hard. And all of that is taken into account. There are many events today, but there's also MedCop21 in Marseille today and tomorrow. That brings together all the players, including the local authorities around the Mediterranean, to discuss what they are doing in specific terms in fighting climate change and global warming. Now, secondly, yes, of course, we have to think about helping other countries. And that's why we intend to share good practices, share solutions that work. The young lady said this a minute ago, that this is about survival, of course. And we have to get moving, all of us, because there's only one planet, only one world. There's no plan B, there's no world B, as the Secretary General of the UN said either. So we have to mobilize. And now, it's also important, I think, to bear in mind the fact that the COP is not something which works in isolation. Everybody, I think, is aware of the fact that this year there's another major meeting, and that's the post-2015 agenda. There will be an opportunity, as many of you have stressed, to think about not just some solutions, but rather rethinking about a new economic model, which would be broader. And then we perhaps need to think about how we tie in this post-2015 agenda, which will be a real revolution in the design of development policies. It will be a universal agenda. We're no longer looking at north and south, but rather all of the world committing to the same goals. And so we need to link that in to the climate change problem as well. And just by way of conclusion, I'd like to say that for the time being, what's most important is to focus on the agreement. We absolutely must get an ambitious agreement in Paris. In spite of everything that's been said and the positive comments and the mobilization, that's not enough. We need an ambitious binding agreement in Paris. And we need countries to be committed and to take that commitment at the highest level in order to then be able to succeed in limiting global warming subsequent to that. And I think that's those are the essential points.
We would probably want to come back to, but thank you very much. I'm going to summarize. I'm going to ask you for your opinion. I'm going to say one more thing, and then we're going to say our thank yous, and then we're going to go and have lunch. Look, we haven't had any discussion about how important climate change is, but it has been said a number of times. And if we don't get Paris right and the process right, there will be no development and the SDGs can be thrown out of the window. That's a really important starting point. It's not the conclusion, but it's the starting point for the conversation. Paris is not the end, it's the beginning, or it's a staging post. And it will be really important to make it a strong staging post, as strong as we can, and to make sure that we have accountability. It has to be contraignant, it has to be constraining in some way, it has to be legal, but it has to provide a platform for further work. It's really important that so many developing countries are now involved and showing leadership and taking their own steps towards it, towards reducing carbon emissions. But the Paris deal is not a done deal, and unless we get the commitments, the finance, the capacity building, the technology, the genuine sharing and partnership that is implied by this process, then Paris will not be a success. So we have a lot of work to do. And how are we going to achieve change? We absolutely have to have the public pressure, the political leadership, the compensation for losers, the complete package of political management that is going to deliver some sort of consensus in Paris. And by no means have we finished. I started out by asking you whether you are optimistic or pessimistic. Let's revisit that vote, but let me change the wording slightly. Having heard all this conversation and having contributed yourselves, are you more optimistic or less optimistic than you were an hour and a half ago? Hands up if you're more optimistic. Hands up if you're less optimistic. Well, we've made some progress. Congratulations to you. You need to go away and read the report, Our Collective Interest, by the European think tanks, which has a strong message on climate change. You need to find the annual report of CDKN out this week, which contains lots of good stories about how the negotiation and the development process can be brought together. At the beginning of that report, I said, we all need to work harder and faster on climate change, but who is we? And actually, the answer to who is we is, it's you. And unless we get a lot of energy, a lot of political activism, and a lot of effort into supporting the kinds of people we have on the platform, we're not going to get a deal in Paris. So I need you to make a covenant with the planet. I need you to go away and ask yourselves this question. What am I personally going to do on Monday when I get home and back to the office that will make climate-compatible development a reality? Because we cannot live in chimneys and silos and boxes and not put climate at the heart of everything we do. So I'm going to take all your email addresses and I'll be writing to you to find out what you're going to do on Monday morning. It's not we, it's you, and of course it's us also. You've been really helpful in helping to develop the conversation. Thank you to all of you, but please join me in thanking this excellent panel.